First, they told us it was the spray cans. Now they're saying it's our cars that are the problem. I thought they fixed that hole in the ozone, right? Here's the deal. The story of the ozone hole begins way back in the 1920s, when the first refrigerators and air conditioners were using some toxic and even explosive chemicals to keep cool. Imagine if going to the fridge were like a game of Russian roulette. So you can see how exciting it was when a research team at General Motors found something better. They figured out how to combine and stabilize new chemical substances called chlorofluorocarbons, or CFCs. These brand new man-made chemicals were non-flammable, non-toxic, and very stable. So they quickly replaced the old dangerous ones used in refrigerators of the day. In fact, they were so effective that within just a few decades, they were being used for all kinds of things. Air conditioners, aerosol spray cans, fire extinguishers. But what happened to those CFCs when the air conditioners broke, or the fridge coolant tubes ruptured, or the spray cans leaked? These chemicals, which had never existed before in nature, got out into the atmosphere. And there, the fact that they were incredibly long-lived was actually not a good thing. In fact, it was very bad. Why? Well, because there are no natural predators for CFCs in the lower atmosphere, they eventually rise all the way up to the upper atmosphere. What's up there? Two important things. Number one, a lot of incoming ultraviolet or UV radiation from the sun. And number two, our protective ozone layer that keeps us safe from most of the sun's cancer-causing UV rays. And here's where things get bad. Because when CFCs encounter UV radiation, they do react, releasing the chlorine in the molecule. And this chlorine, as well as the fluorine and the bromine that was used in later chemicals, reacts with, you guessed it, ozone. So there we were, manufacturing more and more fridges and air conditioners and spray cans, and inventing all kinds of stable new chemicals for new purposes, including to fill up Nike Air shoes back in the day. But little did we know, the whole time, all of these chemicals were building up in the upper atmosphere, most of all at the poles, because that's where the circulation of the atmosphere tended to push them. By the early 80s, scientists started to detect startling drops in the thickness of the ozone layer over the South Pole. But these drops were so sudden and so severe that initially they were chalked up to measurement error. There must be something wrong with the instruments, each scientist thought to themselves. But when they began to compare notes, they realized it wasn't just their instrument that was finding this, it was everybody else's too. And once they realized it was real, it didn't take too long to identify the culprit. CFCs were to blame. But hang on. If you live in a big city, you've probably experienced an ozone alert in the summer. It's a notification that ozone levels are high, so you shouldn't exercise outdoors. And people who have asthma or other breathing conditions, they need to be careful. So isn't ozone a bad thing? Yes, ozone near the ground is bad for us. Ground level ozone comes from pollutants called nitrogen oxides and volatile organic compounds when they react together with sunlight. When we breathe in that ozone pollution, it makes us sick. But naturally occurring ozone up in the upper atmosphere, far away from where we breathe, that's actually good for the planet. It protects us from the ultraviolet radiation that's dangerous for life. So ozone down low, bad. Ozone up high, good. And the problem with the CFCs is that they were eating up the good ozone. This means that the protective ozone layer was getting thinner, letting through more UV light from the sun, and even getting so thin that it looked like a hole over the South Pole. Here's the good news though. Once scientists told the world what was going on, the world responded in record-breaking time. In less than a decade, by 1989, the Montreal Protocol entered into force, banning CFCs. It was ratified by 197 countries, making it the first universally ratified treaty in the history of the United Nations. And guess what? The ozone hole is beginning to recover. Initially, it was expected to get back to pre-1980 values within a few decades in the tropics to mid-latitudes where most people live. but it's not recovering quite as forecast. We're not sure why yet, but it might be because of emissions leaking through the cracks, maybe because of new chemicals like paint strippers that aren't covered by the Montreal Protocol. Even still, in 2018, NASA scientists announced that they've been able to definitively connect lower chlorine levels in the upper atmosphere, thanks to the Montreal Protocol, to less ozone being depleted, 20% less now than in 2005. So, what does the ozone hole have to do with global warming? Some people wonder if the Earth is getting warmer because the hole is letting in more heat from the sun. No, it is just letting in more ultraviolet radiation. The planet is warming because of all the heat-trapping gases that we produce that keep the Earth's heat energy from escaping to space. But of course, just like when something happens to our own body, one thing can easily affect another, and the ozone hole is no exception. Here's the true connection between global warming and the ozone hole. Those same chemicals that created the hole in the ozone, they also trap heat. Not nearly as much heat as carbon dioxide and methane, because there isn't nearly as much of them out there. But they are very powerful. By mass, they trap thousands of times more heat than carbon dioxide. For that reason, they're often known as high global warming potential, or high GWP gases. Together, CFCs and all of the other high GWP gases account for just over 10% of human-induced warming from heat-trapping gases. Of course, carbon dioxide accounts for about 65%, and methane another 20%. So that gives us even more reason to get rid of them. And finally, climate change is also messing with the ozone layer's recovery. The poles take the longest to fully recover. By the 2070s, we thought, at first. But as the lower atmosphere warms because of all the heat-trapping gases we emit, the upper atmosphere is actually cooling because it isn't getting all that heat. It's being trapped down low. And that is slowing down the recovery process at the poles. So, no, the ozone hole isn't the same problem as global warming, but they are connected. And, like with so many other things, global warming is making it worse. We've learned a lot from the ozone hole problem. We haven't fixed it yet, but we are on our way. It's a much easier problem than global warming, since CFCs are used in only a small number of ways compared to fossil fuels. And it's been relatively simple to find replacements. Many were found in less than a decade. Our success with the ozone hole so far can serve as encouragement that when we scientists identify a global problem, it is possible to solve it by working together to care for this planet that we call home. Thanks for watching Global Weirding. This episode was brought to you in part by Citizens Climate Lobby. If you have any questions about climate versus weather, let us know during one of our Facebook Live Q&As. And please be sure to check out globalweirdingseries.com for more episodes. See you next time.